next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15997 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15997.
Formally moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15997, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15995, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against this motion should press the request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15995.
Formally moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15995, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is Stage 3 proceedings on the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 80A, the marshalled list, the correction slip to the marshalled list, and the groupings. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division on proceedings this morning. The period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds. Thereafter, I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak button as soon as possible after I call that group. Members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. And I call Group 1, meaning of Burial Authority and Burial Ground. I call Amendment Number 2 in the name of the Minister, a group with amendments as shown in the groupings.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This group of amendments makes a number of changes to references to burial authorities. Most of these are consequential on Amendment 2, which alters the definition of a burial authority. The effect of Amendment 2 is that a burial authority is defined as the person who has responsibility for the management of the burial ground rather than the person who owns the burial ground. This reflects the fact that some burial grounds, particularly private burial ones, are operated by someone other than the owner of the land. It is important that particular duties are placed on the operator, and most of the amendments in this group give effect to that. Amendment 3 provides a specific definition of burial ground for the purposes of Section 2, which places duties on local authorities to provide burial grounds. The effect of this is to make clear that a local authority is required to provide an open burial ground. A number of amendments are required where the Bill places specific duties on local authority burial authorities. Amendments 4 to 10 make drafting changes in connection with the change made by Amendment 2. These ensure that the powers conferred on local authorities by Sections 3 and 4 are not affected by the change in the definition of burial authority made by Amendment 2. Similarly, various drafting changes are required to references to the provision of a burial ground, since it is not always the case that a burial authority is the person that provides a burial ground, but instead is the person with responsibility for the management of the burial ground. Amendments 11 to 17, 20 and 21 give effect to this. Finally, Amendment 71 changes the definition of a burial ground that is given in Section 75, the Bill's interpretation section. Amendments 3 and 10 adjust the meaning of a burial ground in Sections 2 and 4 so that those sections now contain a bespoke definition which is more limited than the definition elsewhere in the Bill. Consequently, the general definition of burial ground for the Bill requires to be adjusted so it does not apply to Sections 2 and 4. Amendment 71 makes that adjustment. I move Amendment 2.
Thank you, Minister. No members asked to speak in this grouping of amendment. Does the Minister wish to wind up? No. The question then is Amendment number 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendments number 3 to 17 all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move amendments 3 to 17 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Has any member objection to a single question being put on amendments 3 to 17? We have not. No member has objected, so the question is that amendments numbers 3 to 17 en bloc are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Group 2, minor and technical. I call amendment number 18 in the group name of the Minister, which is grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. The Minister is to move amendment number 18 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 18 is a structural change to the bill to move section 20 so it sits with the sections relating to burial in a burial ground. It will be placed in the bill after section 15. This is a minor drafting change to the bill. Amendments 19 and 22 are minor technical adjustments. They ensure the system for applying for an exhumation and the issuing of guidance about burial authorities' functions operate effectively. There have been a number of amendments to the bill in relation to stillbirth, including one providing for the definition of stillbirth to be put into section 75, the interpretation section. Amendment 28 removes the definition from section 47. Amendment 35 removes the definition of stillbirth and stillborn child from section 47B. These are now provided at the interpretation section and so are no longer needed here. Amendments 42 and 44 move sections 48 and 49, so they will appear after section 47. These amendments regroup those sections following the insertion of various new sections between section 47 and 48 at stage 2. Amendments 98 and 99 make minor changes to section 62, which confers powers on inspectors to enter certain types of premises. Amendment 98 would enable an inspector, if authorised by the Scottish Ministers, to enter premises associated with the carrying out of functions of burial authorities and others. Doing so will ensure that all activities of burial and cremation authorities and of funeral directors are dealt with and give inspectors the power to carry out inspections wherever necessary. Amendment 99 makes a necessary consequential change. Amendments 69 and 70 change references to documents or records to documents, records and registers. The effect of this is to make it an offence for a person to fail to comply with an instruction by an inspector to produce a document, record or register. This will ensure that information in each of these formats can be viewed by an inspector for the purposes of Section 62. Amendment 72 adds definitions of stillbirth and stillborn child to the interpretation section of the bill. Amendments 102 to 107 are minor technical amendments to the table of repeals in Schedule 2. Amendment 73 is a technical amendment which ensures that the long title of the bill accurately reflects the content of the bill, including the amendments made at Stage 2 and the proposed amendments at Stage 3. So I move Amendment 18.
No members asked to speak in this group. Does Minister Weaver right to sum up? Thank you. The question then is Amendment number 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendments number 19, 20, 21 and 22, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move the amendments 19 to 22 en bloc.
I move en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question being put on amendments 19 to 22? No member has objected. The question then is amendments numbers 19 to 22 en bloc are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Group 3, Cremation Authority Duties. I call Amendment number 74 in the name of the Minister in a group of its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 74.
Amendment 74 updates Section 37 to put beyond doubt that any regulations that Scottish Ministers may make in relation to the operation of a crematorium can include the operation of the equipment for carrying out the cremation.
Thank you. No members asked to speak in this group. Minister, you waive your right. Thank you. The question is, amendment number 74 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Group 4, location of crematorium. I call amendment number 75 in the name of the Minister in a group of its own. Minister, to move and speak to amendment number 75.
The purpose of Amendment 75 is to remove Section 42A from the bill. Section 42A was inserted into the bill at Stage 2. At Stage 2, I said that I considered this kind of statutory minimum distance to be unnecessary because decisions about the location of crematoriums are rightly a matter for the planning system, as are decisions about development adjacent to crematoriums. A statutory minimum distance is inflexibly arbitrary and an unnecessary blunt solution to this issue. It has the potential to undermine the functioning of the planning system and place unnecessary restrictions on the provision of both crematoriums and housing. Throughout the bill's passage, I have expressed the view that the proposed location of a new crematorium is a matter properly dealt with by the planning system. I continue to be of that opinion. All planning applications are determined on their individual merit in accordance with the local development plan and all material considerations. What may be regarded as a material consideration is a matter for the planning authority concerned and may include matters such as privacy and decency, preservation of sanctity, tranquility, traffic and increased footfall, which are all matters that are relevant to crematoriums. Location and the individual characteristics of the site and proposal are likely to be key considerations in decision-making. None of this will be taken into account by statutory minimum distance, which will simply be a rigid and arbitrary distance with no particular justification or purpose. I understand the concerns that are at the root of Section 42A. It is important that crematoriums are tranquil places of peaceful contemplation. Nonetheless, I continue to believe that the best way to achieve this is through the planning system. A 200-metre distance offers no guarantee of this. Indeed, Section 42A says nothing about any kind of development other than crematoriums and housing, and would not necessarily do anything to offer any kind of screening for the crematorium or take account of any other local circumstances. In seeking to remove Section 42A from the bill, I commit the Scottish Government to providing specific policy advice for planning authorities to assist in considering planning applications for crematoriums as part of the next revision of Scottish planning policy. Scottish planning policy promotes consistency while allowing sufficient flexibility to reflect local circumstances. I believe this would be the most effective way to ensure that planning authorities consistently consider relevant issues in the context of specific locations when assessing development applications for crematoriums. Planning policy of this type is already provided by Scottish planning policy in relation to other types of development. For example, Scottish planning policy advises planning authorities to consider buffer zones between dwellings and some waste management facilities, and advises on preferred distances for particular types of facilities. Similarly, community separation is one of the factors to be considered when planning for the location of onshore wind farms. I know that some people are concerned that Scottish planning policy is not statutory. However, the Town and County and Country Planning Scotland Act 1997 requires planning applications to be determined in accordance with the development plan unless material considerations indicate otherwise. As a statement of ministers' priorities, the content of Scottish planning policy is a material consideration that carries significant weight. Setting out guidance about the location of crematoriums in Scottish planning policy ensures that all planning authorities will consider crematoriums in a consistent way. It will allow local circumstances to be taken into account, meaning that planning decisions about crematoriums reflect local circumstances in a way that would not be possible with a statutory minimum distance. Such issues are dealt with well by the planning system currently, and I believe that this is an appropriate way to address the issues raised in relation to crematoriums. I want decisions about where crematoriums are located to be handled sensitively and consistently by the planning system, and I believe the approach I have outlined will achieve this. I move Amendment 75.
Thank you, Stuart Stevenson, followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a very odd section, 42A. Reading it, I take from it that there are two policy intentions. The first policy intention is to protect residential properties that exist from having a crematorium built at the bottom of the garden, so to speak. And the other of which is to protect crematoria's peace and tranquility, as the Minister referred to, from the encroachment of nearby residential properties. The very immediate difficulty is that it's incomplete, if that's the policy objective, in that in no sense does it prevent the redesignation of something that might be within 200 metres as a residential property. So therefore, in terms of the way this section has been constructed, it fails to meet one of those policy objectives. The second issue that one might consider in relation to protecting the peace and tranquility of the crematorium and the grounds, which often contain memorials to those who have been cremated, is that it doesn't address a wide range of other things that might fall within 200 metres. And let's just think of some of the ones there might be. A school, a play park, cinema, theatre, public house or a restaurant. If you want to protect the peace and tranquility of a crematorium, you would need to consider that as an issue, not simply ban residential properties. So I think in terms of the policy objectives that there are captured in Section 42A, it is not constructed to deliver adequately on either of them. I think the Minister, however, and I speak as a former planning minister, makes an excellent point when she says to put this into primary legislation is a very odd way to deal with a planning issue. The National Planning Guidelines would be a much more appropriate place, because that leaves the councils, who are the planning authorities, the discretion to make decisions that are appropriate to the circumstances before them. And in particular, the circumstances may be very different in a rural location from those that will prevail in an urban location. So, Presiding Officer, I conclude my remarks by saying I think we, with regret perhaps to the policy intentions of the person who inserted 42A, have to at this stage remove it and deal with this issue in a more appropriate way via the planning system.
Rhoda Grant, followed by John Wilson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too am concerned about this amendment. The Minister went on at some length about planning policy, and I think we would all hope that the planning authority would make reasonable decisions when considering a planning application. But I think it's perfectly reasonable that they would certainly not consider a planning application for either housing or a crematorium within 200 metres of each other. But we also know that planning decisions are not always made properly. And this amendment that is about to be removed gives protection both for residences and for crematorium. Congestion could cause a huge problem for people living close by, especially road safety issues for people with young families. And also the noise and disruption caused by residents could actually upset those attending a crematorium for a funeral. So I think... Yes?
John Mason.
Local authority would not be concerned about these matters.
Rhoda Grant.
I would sincerely hope that the local authority would be concerned about those matters, but we've seen in the past local authorities making decisions that fly in the face of this. Even in spite of residents' campaigns, we've seen planning permission granted for things that we wouldn't see the sense of. There's another issue at stake here, Presiding Officer, and I think you yourself are on the record about talking about the role of committees to hold the government to account. This is one of the very rare occasions where a committee has put through an amendment at stage two against the will of the government and showing actually that the committees have some teeth. It would be a bit sad if at stage three the government used its weight and power within this chamber to overrule one of those tiny times that the committee has actually raised its voice and held the government to account.
John Wilson, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The amendment at stage 2, 42A, was to address an issue that had been identified by the committee in consideration of the bill at stage 1. And in consideration at stage one, we identified the 1902 Cremation Act. And within that act, there is a stipulation under section 5, site of crematorium. No crematorium shall be constructed nearer to any dwelling house than 200 yards, except with the consent in writing of the owner, lessee and occupier of such house, nor within 50 yards of any public highway, nor in the concentrated part of the burial grounds of any burial authority. Now, in consideration of the bill, we took evidence as a committee, and the evidence was quite clear that a number of those who made written submissions and oral presentations to the committee asked that the limit not only be installed, but actually modernised. And what we received from the Federation of Burial and Cremation Authorities was, rather than have the 200-yard and 50-yard rules removed, the FBCA would like legislators to take action to protect these vital locations and prevent the siting of subsequent developments literally up to the cutlage of the crematoria grounds. That then led to the committee and its stage one report to say the overwhelming majority of the evidence we received asked for the 200-yard rule to be retained and strengthened. We also noted the substantial confusion around how this rule works in conjunction with the planning system. We find it undesirable that the bill does nothing to tackle this level of confusion. We therefore recommend the Scottish Government takes cognizance of the issues raised and, in discussion with planning colleagues, brings forward an amendment at stage two which addresses these concerns. Quite clearly, the committee were concerned enough to put this in its report and asked the Scottish Government to come back at stage two. The Scottish Government did not come back at stage two with an appropriate amendment. In fact, the amendment that was put forward in my name has been challenged today, and its proposal is to take that amendment out. We also received written evidence from Falkirk Council, and Falkirk Council have the experience of actually having properties, housing built up to 110 yards from an existing crematoria. And Falkirk Council's written submission says, "We disagree with removing the existing provision which restricts the proximity of new crematoria to housing. In our view, there are risks involved in reducing or removing the 200-yard limit. In the case of Falkirk Council's crematorium, an existing extensive area of new housing has been developed to within 110 yards of the crematorium buildings. The degree," and it then goes on to say, "the degree of separation should not be determined by the planning process alone, because policies and provisions in local development plan can be overturned on appeal by developers." And this is part of the issue, presiding officer, is while we have to be reassured that the Scottish planning policy will take and address the issues raised, clearly Scottish planning policy can be amended, can be changed, and the local planning authorities' decisions can be overturned on appeal by developers. So there is clearly a need to try and keep something in this legislation that not only protects the crematoria, but also protects local authorities to maintain the barrier between crematoria and new housing developments against the wishes of developers. I ask the Chamber to oppose this amendment when it comes to decision time.
Kevin Shook.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and a number of issues have been raised here today, and often we find conflict between various pieces of legislation, and in this case it's been between the 1902 Act and various planning legislation and guidance. And I, for one, am always keen to ensure that there is no conflict between pieces of legislation, and I think that what we have from Mr. Wilson will create that conflict, presiding officer. I think we should trust planning authorities, local authorities, to take these decisions. After all, they are the folk who know the geography and topography of a particular area. I'll give way to Mr. Wilson.
John Wilson.
Would Mr. Stewart confirm to this chamber that Mr. Stewart was the convener of the Local Government and Regeneration Committee that submitted the Stage 1 report that asked the Scottish Government to consider this issue and bring forward legislation to actually address the issues raised by many of the witnesses that gave evidence to the committee.
I was the convener of the committee, and I did suggest that be looked at. And Mr. Wilson's amendment might have been better worded in terms of dealing with conflicts, if that was what it was supposed to do. But all his amendment did was mention housing. It didn't mention any commercial properties. And I think there would be more difficulty in building a factory next to a crematorium or a crematorium next to a factory rather than housing. And beyond that, what would happen in a situation where there was an application to maybe put a new crematoria in a place where there is already a crematorium and housing round about it? And one of the best examples is actually here in Edinburgh, where there is housing right next to the crematorium. Common sense should come into play here, Presiding Officer. And that common sense approach would be to allow local authorities to look at the geography, the topography in a particular area, and look to see what is suitable or not suitable to be built in a particular area. And I think that if we are going to deal with this, we should deal with it through planning guidance, as has been suggested by the Minister, and put our faith in local councillors to take the right decisions in their areas.
Minister, to wind up.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is true that local authorities agree with minimum distance, but they do believe that it should be them that are making the decision. The Institute of Cemetery and Crematorium Management also supports the use of the planning system, as do local authorities, as I said, such as Glasgow and the Scottish Borders. Distance, as some members have said, is arbitrary. There may, for example, be a dual carriageway between the crematorium and housing. And Kevin Stewart makes an important point about what other than housing might be built next to a crematorium. There are, as members have mentioned, crematorium with housing right round their perimeters, and they manage to live perfectly well. And this decision, what is proposed, was proposed by John Wilson, is not applicable to other larger developments which may well be intrusive. So I ask the Chamber to support my amendment.
Thank you. The question is, amendment number 75 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. As this is the first division of the stage one, I suspend now for 5 minutes.
you. And so the question is that Amendment 75 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not. There will be a division. Please vote now. Result of the vote on amendment number 75 is yes 61, no 38. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore agreed. I now call amendment 23 in the name of the minister, group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Minister, to move amendment 23 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. In themselves, amendments 23 to 27, 29, 31 to 33, 36, 38, 41, 43, 45 to 54, 91, 92, 56, 57 and 60 to 68 do not have any impact on the meaning of the sections they relate to. They are technical drafting amendments to ensure consistency of language throughout the bill. I believe the change to using a more sensitive phrase, that of burial or cremation instead of disposal, is more appropriate and uses more sensitive language. I move Amendment 23.
Thank you very much. And so the question is that Amendment 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. I now call Amendments 24, 25, 26, 27 and 28, all previously debated, and invite the Minister to move Amendments 24 to 28 en bloc, please.
Moved en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question being put in Amendments 24 to 28? As it appears, no member does. The question is that Amendments 24 to 28 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Now move to Group 6. Call Amendment 76 in the name of the Minister. Group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Minister, to move Amendment 76 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Amendments 76 to 83 make various changes to Section 47A. Section 47A relates to a stillbirth which occurs as a result of a post-24-week termination. The cumulative effect of these amendments is to enable a health body to ask the woman what she wants to happen to the remains before the termination occurs. By virtue of Amendment 77, the health professionals must do this if they consider that it's in the woman's best interest to do so. Amendment 84 adds a new section after Section 47A. This new section gives various powers to health authorities where they are authorised to make arrangements by Section 47A. Powers rather than duties are used in this section to provide additional flexibility. The effect of this is that health authorities will be able to make arrangements for the disposal of remains where they are authorised to do so by virtue of Section 47A. Amendment 85 adds a new section after Section 47A. This new section places a duty on health authorities to give a woman the opportunity to make a decision about what she wishes to be done with the remains following a post-24-week termination. This will have the effect where it appears to the health authority that no decision has been made under Section 47A. The new section allows women to make a range of decisions, including authorising the health authority to make the arrangements. Where the woman does not wish to make a decision, is unable to make a decision, or does not inform the health authority of a decision, the health authority may make arrangements for the burial or cremation of the remains. Amendment 86 inserts a further new section after Section 47A. The effect of this is that a health body will be able to ask a woman if she wants to make a decision about arrangements for burial or cremation before the loss occurs in the case of a stillbirth. The health professionals must do this if they consider it is in the woman's best interests to do so. The woman can choose to make the arrangements herself or to authorise the health body to make the arrangements. The woman will be able to instruct the health body to make the arrangements as soon as practicable after the loss occurs. Otherwise, the health authority must wait 7 days after the loss occurs. Amendment 87 inserts a further new section after Section 47A. The effect of this is to set out the process that a health body must follow where it is authorised before the stillbirth occurs to make arrangements for the burial or cremation of the remains. That authorisation is given by the woman by virtue of the section inserted by Amendment 86. If the woman has specified how she wishes the health body to make the arrangements, it must do so as she has specified. Amendments 88 and 34 make various changes to Section 47B. Amendment 88 inserts a new paragraph so that Section 47B has effect where it appears to a health body that no arrangements have been made by virtue of the section inserted by Amendment 86. This means that where a health body does not ask a woman what she wants to happen with the remains before the loss occurs, it must do so after the loss occurs. Amendment 34 adjusts the drafting in relation to requirements around the keeping of information. This does not alter the effect of the provision, but provides consistency with similar duties throughout the bill. Amendment 37 replaces a reference to the appropriate form with the prescribed form in Section 47C. Amendment 39 adjusts the drafting of Section 47D so that a health body can make arrangements for the burial or cremation of remains where it appears that no arrangements have been made or are being made. Amendment 40 adjusts the drafting of Section 48 so that it refers to the burial or cremation of remains rather than their disposal. Amendment 89 inserts a new section after Section 49. This new section provides health bodies with various powers in relation to the burial or cremation of remains of a pregnancy loss that occurs before or on completion of the 24th week. This section applies where a health body is authorised to make arrangements by virtue of Section 54A. The section allows health bodies to make the arrangements and requires them to comply with any wishes expressed by the woman about the burial or cremation of the remains. If a woman authorises the health body to make the arrangements for burial or cremation of the remains as soon as practical after the loss occurs, it must do so, but otherwise it must wait 7 days after the loss occurs before making arrangements. Amendment 90 adds an additional criterion to the circumstances which must be met before Section 50 can have effect. The additional criterion is that it appears to the health authority that no arrangements for the burial or cremation of the remains have been or are being made. Amendment 93 provides a definition of appropriate health authority for the purposes of Section 52A. It is given the same meaning as in Section 56 of the Bill. Amendment 58 and 59 adjust the drafting of Section 54. The effect of these amendments is to add additional criteria to the circumstances that must be met before Section 54 applies. These are that it appears to the health authority that no arrangements for the burial or cremation of the remains have been or are being made. Amendments 94 to 96 make changes to Section 54A. Amendment 94 adjusts the criteria that must be met for the section to apply to include the woman being in the care of a relevant health body. That clarifies when the section will apply. Amendment 95 makes changes to Section 54A so that a health body may ask a woman what she wishes to happen to the remains of a pregnancy loss before that loss occurs. In some instances, this may be preferable for the woman, and this amendment ensures that it can happen. Where the woman makes a decision, the health body must follow her wishes. Amendment 96 moves Section 54A to after Section 49. This places it next to other provisions dealing with the same subject. Amendment 97 changes the section of the bill to which Section 55 applies. This has the effect of requiring health authorities to keep a register of information in relation to Sections 47A to 54, which cover pregnancy loss on or before 24 weeks, post-24 weeks terminations and stillbirths. Where it is known that a pregnancy will result in a stillbirth or will be lost, Amendments 86 and 95 place health bodies under a duty to give a woman the opportunity to say before the pregnancy ends what she wishes to happen to the remains. Importantly, health bodies are given the discretion to decide whether it is appropriate to ask a woman in advance or better to wait until the loss has occurred. In some instances, a woman who knows she will lose her baby may wish to start making arrangements in advance. In other instances, the trauma of being told that her baby will be lost may be so great that it would be better for her to make the decision after the loss occurs. The approach set out in these amendments means that a health body can act accordingly, depending on the interests of each individual woman who experiences such a loss. If the health body considers that it would be better not to ask a woman before the loss occurs, it is nonetheless still a duty to give the woman the opportunity to decide after the loss occurs. Amendments 86 and 95 have the effect of allowing health professionals to use their judgment as to whether it is better to raise this difficult subject with a woman before or after the loss occurs. This approach ensures that a woman's best interests are always the priority. It will always be the woman who makes the decision. The intention of Amendments 86 and 95 is to ensure that no woman is required to make this decision before she is ready to do so. These amendments provide that flexibility and person-centred approach. The effects of Amendments 86A and 95A in Malcolm Chisholm's name, would be to remove the health body's discretion, meaning that in every instance where it is known that a pregnancy will end or a stillbirth will occur, the health body must ask a woman what she wants to happen to the remains, regardless of whether the woman is ready to do so. I think this is unnecessarily rigid, removing the health professional's ability to judge whether or not a woman should be confronted with this decision before the loss has occurred. If these amendments are agreed, it will mean that every woman will be asked what she wants to happen to the remains of a pregnancy loss or stillborn baby while she is still coming to terms with the fact that her baby has died. I move Amendment 76.
Many thanks. Now call on Malcolm Chisholm to speak to Amendment 86A and other amendments in the group. Please, Mr Chisholm.
At stage one, the Minister said, and I totally agreed with her, in setting out what will happen after a pregnancy loss, the Bill ensures that the woman who has experienced loss is at the centre of the decision-making process. And I was concerned in committee that the words in relation to another situation appeared in the words that are in three of these amendments, and I quote them, if the appropriate health body considers that it will be in the woman's best interest to do so. The situation that arose during the Health Committee was where 6 weeks had elapsed and a decision had to be made about what happened to the remains, and the Minister argued that those words were appropriate because perhaps in that situation the woman should not be asked. And I did reluctantly accept that explanation. When I saw the words attached to the situations described in Amendments 77, 85 and 86 and 95, I was alarmed because it seemed that the principle of deciding in what appeared to be a paternalistic way what the woman's best interest was being extended to these new situations. And I remembered what the Minister said at committee when she said, if the woman, quoting again, is still involved in the process, it will be entirely her view that is taken into account. So it did seem to me that there was perhaps a potential loophole here if in various situations the authorities were going to decide on the woman's behalf. But if the Minister can confirm this is purely a matter of timing, then of course that completely changes the situation. It wasn't apparent from the amendments which came in on the last day that this was the case. So if the Minister could confirm that it is purely a matter of timing and that in these situations the woman will always be asked, possibly after rather than before the loss of the pregnancy loss, then of course I shall not move these particular amendments.
We call on Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The reason I want to speak in relation to this group of amendments was the Minister's reference to Section 54A, which has been moved within one of the amendments in this group to another section within the bill. Can I welcome the provision within 54A to put a duty on health board for pregnancy loss is likely to occur? And I'm sure many members in this chamber know there are many occasions where many women are sent home knowing that the pregnancy is likely to end in a loss and little choice is given to those ladies and to the families, and this strengthens the power and choice that these individuals and families have. However, I do also note that this provision kicks in when the women are in the care of an appropriate health authority, and it might be worth getting some clarification. At what point is it deemed that the woman is in care of the appropriate health authority? Is it a 12-week scan? Is it once the GP is informed that the lady is pregnant? At what stage do these obligations kick in? Perhaps a little bit more thought has to be needed in relation to that, particularly for women and families who suffer from recurrent miscarriages or pregnancy losses and losing their unborn children.
Thank you. Now I call Dr. Nanette Milne.
Thank you. I'll speak very, very briefly, Presiding Officer. I welcome these amendments. I share Malcolm Chisholm's concern and look forward to what the Minister says in regard to his amendments. But these issues were discussed quite a bit by some of the bereaved parents with members of the Health Committee, and obviously very sensitive issues, and I think the women involved would feel very strongly that to put their interests first and discuss matters with them so they can make up their mind when they feel able to do so is the right way to go. So I'm very happy with this set of amendments. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on the Minister to wind up, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. All provisions relating to pregnancy loss and stillbirth are based on flexibility and the centrality of the woman in the decision-making process. These amendments proposed by Malcolm Chisholm, I think, would remove that important flexibility, and I don't think that it best serves the interests of the women who have just learned that their pregnancy will be lost. So it is absolutely about timing, and I believe my amendments provide that timing. I think Bob Doris introduces something that's not in relation to these particular amendments of more early pregnancy loss, and I'm happy that Nanette Mill believes that my amendments serve the purpose they're intended.
And many thanks. And the question is that Amendment 76 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Now call Amendment 77 in the name of the Minister. Minister, to move, please.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 77 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. I now call Amendments 78, 79, 29, 80, 30 and 81 to 85, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move these amendments en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question being put on these amendments? As it appears no member does, the question is that Amendments 78, 79, 29, 80, 30 and 81 to 85 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Many thanks. I now call Amendment 86 in the name of the Minister. Minister, to move, please.
Moved.
Many thanks. And so I also now call Amendment 86A in the name of Malcolm Chisholm. Mr. Chisholm, to move or not?
Not moved.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 86 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Now call Amendment 87, 88, 31 to 44, 89, 90, 45 to 54, 91 to 93, 55 to 66 and 94. All in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move these amendments en bloc, please.
Moved en bloc.
Many thanks. Does any member object to a single question being put on these amendments? As no member does, the question is that Amendments 87, 88, 31 to 44, 89, 90, 45 to 54, 91 to 93, 55 to 66 and 94 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many, many thanks. And so we now move swiftly on to call Amendment 95 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 76. Minister, to move, please.
Moved.
Many thanks. And call Amendment 95A in the name of Malcolm Chisholm, already debated with Amendment 76. Malcolm Chisholm, to move or not?
Not moved.
Thank you. And so the question is that Amendment 95 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Call Amendments 96, 67, 97, 68, 98, 99, 69 and 70, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Minister, to move these amendments on block, please.
Moved on block.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on these amendments? As it appears no member does, the question is that Amendments 96, 67, 97, 68, 98, 99, 69 and 70 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Now move to Group 7. Call Amendment 1 in the name of Leslie Brennan in a group on its own. Leslie Brennan, to move and speak to Amendment 1, please.
Thank you. At stage 2, I moved this amendment and the Minister said I support the principle behind the amendment. So I really welcome today the note that actually the government is going to support this amendment. The Minister also stated during stage 2 that funeral costs have been debated repeatedly throughout the bill's passage. The bill's central purpose is to improve legislation governing burial and cremations. I remain of the view that the bill is not the right place to tackle funeral poverty. So that's what the Minister said at stage 2. I do not disagree with the central purpose, but it doesn't exclude guidance on funeral costs and the desirability of such costs be affordable. So I really do welcome the fact that the government is going to support this amendment at stage 3. The Minister didn't make any comments about the drafting of the amendment, but rather the Minister suggested that such a provision did not need to be included in the bill. But I felt differently, especially reading the consultation responses, thus I lodged it again. In the consultation document for this bill, there was a section on funeral poverty. The Minister sought answers to questions regarding funeral poverty, and the primary focus of these questions was local authorities. However, the final question states, what else could be done to reduce funeral costs and ensure that they remain affordable to everyone? Thus, I consider amending this bill to incorporate a duty to produce guidance which will improve the current position. Consultation responses suggest in some areas third sector organisations have produced guidance looking at how to make funerals more affordable. But the coverage is patchy, thus this amendment will ensure consistency of information across Scotland. The Citizens Advice Bureau state 19% of issues raised with Scottish CABs regarding bereavement is funeral poverty. So it's really good today that this amendment is adopted, that it's a start in the process of eradicating funeral poverty. So I really do welcome the support from the government. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now calling Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased that the government are going to accept this amendment today. And I think that we have some opportunities coming up, as has been discussed at the Local Government Committee and at the Welfare Reform Committee of late. And, of course, Social Justice Secretary Alec Neil said our new powers over funeral payments will give us the opportunity to set up a benefit which is simpler and more streamlined. We heard during the course of our evidence about the profitability that some private companies have in terms of dealing with funeral services, cremation in particular. And I'd also like to pay tribute to Citizens Advice Scotland for the work that they have done in this area. And I hope that the Parliament will agree to accept this amendment today.
Okay, thanks, Minister.
There is no doubt that funeral costs continue to be an area of concern for many people, and indeed this issue has been debated repeatedly throughout the bill's passage. Where possible, the bill supports greater transparency of costs, For example, the bill was amended at stage two to require local authorities to publish full details of their burial and funeral costs. Funeral costs are complex as they are made up of a number of different elements. I know that it can sometimes be difficult to understand exactly what is included in these costs. I believe that it is important that costs associated with funerals are as transparent as possible. This includes clear pricing structures and being clear about the elements of a funeral that are necessary and those that are not. There has been much discussion about making funeral costs affordable. This is undoubtedly an important aim, but it is not necessarily straightforward. For example, a person may choose a particular type of coffin or a particular floral tribute, which increases the overall costs of the funeral. There are numerous factors which can affect the real cost of a funeral. The Scottish Government has worked closely with funeral directors, burial authorities and cremation authorities in developing the bill, and will continue to do so when implementing the new legislation. In particular, I am keen that funeral directors' costs should be more transparent and that people should know that they can choose certain elements but not others when arranging a funeral. This is something that will be addressed when implementing the legislation. The Scottish Government is already working to address funeral costs generally and funeral poverty specifically. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Communities and Pensioners' Rights is leading on important work to address funeral costs and funeral poverty. Alec Neil has recently published advice to the general public about what to do when faced with organising a funeral. This includes advice on costs, including ways to reduce costs while still providing a dignified and respectful funeral. The Cabinet Secretary has also commissioned work on funeral poverty, and a report will be published. In response, the Cabinet Secretary is undertaking a range of work to address funeral costs, including speeding up the time taken to make decisions about funeral payments once responsibility for this is devolved. Officials who are developing policy on those issues have engaged with a wide range of experts, including academics from the University of Bath that Leslie Brennan has mentioned in previous debates. This is important work that should have a significant impact on the underlying causes of funeral poverty in the long term. Given the work the Scottish Government is already doing to address funeral costs and our intention to continue working closely with the funeral industry on this issue after the bill comes into force, I believe that Leslie Brennan's amendment would place an important marker in the bill, and as such, I am pleased to support the amendment.
Many thanks. I now call on Leslie Brennan to wind up.
I just want to say thank you very much to the Government for supporting this amendment. I think we need to recognise that this is the start of a process to eradicate funeral poverty in Scotland. I think during stage two, I recognise the fact that power over the Social Fund funeral payment was coming in the New Scotland Bill, and also about consumer protection was also in the Scotland Bill. But this guidance and the adoption of this amendment on the face of the bill is an important first step in eradicating poverty, funeral poverty in Scotland. So I really do welcome the Government's support on this. Thank you.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Many thanks. And now move to Group 8, and I call Amendment 100 in the name of the Minister, Group with Amendment 101. Minister, to move Amendment 100 and speak to both amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 100 removes Section 73, bracket 6, which sets out consultation requirements in relation to regulations made about the licensing of funeral directors. This is no longer required because Amendment 101 inserts a new section which sets out fuller consultation requirements as well as placing additional duties on Scottish ministers in relation to developing a licensing scheme. Amendment 101 inserts a new section after Section 73. This sets out a range of requirements in relation to any regulations made by Scottish ministers under Section 66, bracket 1, about the licensing scheme for funeral directors. Before laying a draft of such regulations before Parliament, Scottish ministers will be required to prepare a draft of the regulations they propose to make. They must then consult on that draft with persons representing funeral directors and anyone else ministers consider appropriate. Ministers must have regard to any representations made during the consultation and must then lay a draft of the regulations before the Scottish Parliament. In addition, ministers must also lay a document which sets out how representations made during consultation have been taken into account in finalising the draft laid before the Parliament. The convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee wrote to me after stage two to set out the committee's ongoing concerns about the power in the bill to make regulations about the licensing of funeral directors. I am confident that the original approach to this offered sufficient detail and safeguards, but I recognise the committee's concerns and have lodged these two amendments in response. So I hope these reassure the committee and members. I move Amendment 100.
Many thanks. I now call on Nigel Dawn.
Who is, of course, the aforementioned convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, which committee welcomes these amendments as a response to our concerns. Section 66 of the bill contains a revised power allowing Scottish ministers to make regulations for or in connection with a licensing scheme for funeral directors' businesses. This power was subject to the affirmative procedure. Given the extent of the power and its potential impact on the individuals, the committee encouraged the Scottish Government to bring forward, at the very least, an amendment to attach an enhanced form of affirmative procedure to that power, which these amendments now do. However, I would like to put on record that the committee continues to believe that licensing regimes ought, as a matter of principle, to be set out substantially in primary legislation rather than delegated entirely to regulations. The committee accepts that some matters of technical or administrative detail relating to such schemes could appropriately be set out in regulations, but the committee is of the view that delegation of power to create an entirely new licensing scheme in subordinate legislation, whether in this bill or in any other, does not strike an acceptable balance between primary and secondary legislation. Accordingly, the committee's preference would have been for matters relating to the licensing of funeral directors' businesses to be set out more fully on the face of the bill. Recognising the time constraints, the committee appreciates that it's not been possible to develop such detail on the face of the bill, and the committee therefore accepts that an enhanced form of affirmative procedure will enable the Parliament to scrutinise and influence the development of proposals on licensing before the regulations are laid for approval in accordance with the affirmative procedure. And if I might, Presiding Officer, recognising that the Minister for Parliament is also here just at the moment, one aside, it would be helpful, I think, to the committee in the future had there been some recognised form of words about an enhanced form of scrutiny. Now, I do understand that we maybe don't want one laid down in statute, but I think if we had a form of words which cover the issues of preparing a draft, consulting, laying a draft that summarises representations, describes the changes and the affirmative procedure, which is exactly what's in front of us, if we as a committee and yourself and other committees had a form of words which we could refer to, that might make life an awful lot easier in the future.
Many thanks. I now call on the Minister to wind up, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy that the convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee is pleased that I've gone some way to address their concerns. I'm sure in the next Parliament some committee will take up the looking into the situation with funeral directors and how we proceed to make sure that the funeral industry addresses the needs of our citizens.
Thank you. And so the question is that Amendment 100 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Now call Amendments 101, 71, 72, 102 to 107 and 73, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move these amendments on block, please.
Moved on block.
Many thanks. Does any member object to a single question being put on these amendments? As it appears no member does, the question is that amendments 101, 71, 72, 102 to 107 and 73 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Many thanks. And that ends consideration of amendments. And we now move to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15996, in the name of Maureen Watt on the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And before I invite the Minister to open the debate, I call on the Cabinet Secretary to signify Crown consent to the Bill, please. I now call, therefore, on Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson, please.
Okay, for the purposes of Rule 9.11 of the Standing Orders, I wish to advise the Parliament that Her Majesty, having been informed of the purport of the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill, has consented to place her prerogative and interest, so far as they are affected by the Bill, at the disposal of the Parliament for the purposes of the Bill.
Many thanks. And so we now begin the debate, and I now call on Cabinet Minister Maureen Watt to speak to and move the motion. Minister, you have 10 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm delighted to open the Stage 3 debate on the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. I thank the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, the Local Government and Regeneration Committee, and the Health and Sport Committee for the rigour with which they have each considered the bill. The subject matter of this bill is not something many of us are keen to think or talk about. Nonetheless, these are important matters, and it is vital that burial and cremation processes are robust, consistent, and fit for 21st century Scotland. Recent events, as well as evidence at Stage 1, suggest this has not always been the case. This bill will make important and much-needed changes to burial and cremation processes and will help to ensure that those processes are easy to understand, reliable, and fit for purpose. The existing legislation for burial and cremation is extremely old. The legislation for burial dates back to 1855, while the current cremation legislation is from 1902, when cremation was a new and largely untested process. We have come a long way since then, but the current legislation continues to reflect older and very different expectations about death and what should be done with human remains. As our attitudes change towards death, the treatment of human remains and how we remember the dead, the current legislation is increasingly found wanting. It is right that we should put in place legislation that reflects modern Scotland and supports our expectations about the respect and dignity with which human remains should be treated. And I believe that this bill will do that. The bill's passage has been marked by broad agreement on the need for new legislation and support for the bill's key provisions. Nonetheless, key areas of the bill have undoubtedly been strengthened by the parliamentary process. In particular, the provisions relating to stillborn babies and pregnancy loss have benefited greatly from the evidence given by various people at Stage 1 and the recommendations made by the Health and Sport Committee. Much of the bill is based on recommendations made by Lord Bonamy's Infant Cremation Commission, and is particularly important that these provisions address problems that have arisen in the past. Some of those who gave evidence to the Health and Sport Committee were healthcare professionals, drawing from years of working with people who have suffered the devastation of losing a pregnancy or a baby, and I am pleased that the bill reflects that collective experience. Others who gave evidence had personally experienced such a loss and in many instances had also been affected directly by past failing in relation to the disposal of ashes. Indeed, many people whose losses were compounded by the torment of not knowing what happened to their baby's remains have been involved with the development of the bill, as well as with other non-legislative work that has emerged from Lord Bonamy's report. I thank them for their continued commitment to ensuring that these mistakes do not happen again. At Stage 2, a number of amendments were made to the processes that will apply in the case of a pre-24-week pregnancy loss or a stillbirth. These will provide improved clarity and consistency while ensuring that women are not rushed into making decisions before they are ready. The woman who experiences the loss is rightly placed at the centre of the process, and at every step of the process, she will have the opportunity to make decisions about what she wants to happen to the remains. Several of the amendments I lodged today at Stage 3 provide additional flexibility, ensuring that women have every opportunity to make a decision about what they wish to do. An important point that emerged from stage one was the tension between ensuring a woman was able to make a decision in her own time and making sure that remains are able to be buried or cremated when it becomes clear that the woman does not wish to make a decision. The bill set out an initial six-week period between a loss occurring and a decision being made about burial or cremation. And while it was always the intention that a hospital could go beyond this six-week deadline, where a woman was still trying to decide what should happen to the remains, the bill was amended at stage two to provide a clearer route for this to happen. In developing provisions about pregnancy, loss and stillbirth, we have ensured that the woman is always at the centre of the decision-making process. This extends to situations where it is known in advance that a pregnancy will be lost or will result in a stillbirth. The hospital must ask this question, but the bill gives the health professionals the discretion to decide whether it is best to ask the woman before or after the loss occurs. Other amendments were made to the bill at stage two to set out a clear process for what should be done with ashes. These amendments will make sure that a cremation cannot be carried out unless the applicant has stated that he or she wishes what he or she wishes to be done with the ashes. Cremation authorities are placed under a duty to carry out the applicant's wishes. The bill sets out a clear process for cremation authorities and funeral directors about what should happen where ashes are not collected as agreed. These are important steps that will provide consistency and clarity about what will be done with ashes. Considerable debate has also taken place about the location of crematoriums in relation to housing, and I'm glad that this will now be left in the local authorities' hands and in favour of the planning decision making the decisions about the location, because it is something that is sensibly placed with local authorities. In speaking to my amendment about distance, the Scottish Government, as I said, will bring forward specific planning policy about this issue, setting out the issues that planning authorities should consider when assessing development proposals for crematoriums, including steps that can be taken to support a quiet environment. Such guidance will be included in the next revision of Scottish planning policy. Guidance on separation distances between particular types of development and housing is already contained in the Scottish planning policy, and it is right that matters relating to crematoriums are also set out there. This will ensure a consistent approach to the siting of crematoriums while leaving scope for appropriate local decisions to be made. So, Presiding Officer, this bill will bring about important improvements to burial and cremation, creating a system that meets the needs of modern Scotland and prevents a repeat of previous mistakes. And I hope that the Parliament will agree to this bill being passed at decision time.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Mara. 7 minutes on thereby, please, Ms. Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to start in the same way as the Minister by thanking the Health Committee, the Local Government Committee and the Delegated Powers Committee for their careful and scrupulous consideration of this bill over the past few weeks and months, Presiding Officer. It is, as the Minister said, an extremely important bill because it addresses so crucial issues around the dignity of death and the importance of making sure that all of our loved ones and every citizen in this country has a dignified death, burial or cremation, and that their families are able to afford to give their loved one that dignity of death, and the appropriate arrangements are in place by statute to surround it. Presiding Officer, this passage of this bill in the last days of this Parliament has given me time to reflect a little bit on some of the representations I have had over the past 5 years. and the constituents coming to me surrounding difficulties and issues around death, burial and cremation have certainly not been absent in my surgery, and I'm sure many other members in the chamber would share that experience, and so very much welcome the improved arrangements, as the Minister said, for death, burial and cremation in modern Scotland. Today, I'd like to explore a few of the issues that we discussed at stage three, Presiding Officer, because I think this bill has been a good example of the legislation evolving through the stages of the parliamentary process. Of course, the most sensitive issue that and probably by far the most important issue that the bill has dealt with over the past few weeks and months has been the provisions around women's decisions on what happens to the remains of their unborn children following either stillbirth, pregnancy loss or termination. And I'd like to say that the Scottish Labour Party very much welcomes the government's amendments today. I think the Minister has made great improvements around the clarity of the process, both for the families but also for the health bodies. Malcolm Chisholm's amendment identified a potential loophole, but it was very good today that the Minister was able to confirm that her intention was regarding timing, and I think Parliament was in complete agreement that the bill is putting the correct and most appropriate and sensitive arrangements in place, and this is to be very much welcomed. On the issue of exclusion zones, Presiding Officer, I briefly argued at stage one that these decisions should rest with the local planning process. Now, this is the decision that the government has taken today. We, however, were persuaded by the arguments at stage two in committee and voted as thus at stage two and stage three today for the amendment that no residential property should be constructed within 200 metres of any crematorium. I think the evidence was strong on either side, and although we took that position, I think it's good that we've come to an overall position on that today. Presiding Officer, my colleague Leslie Brennan raised some very persuasive issues right throughout, I think, since she came into this Parliament, throughout the passage of this bill surrounding stage funeral poverty. And Leslie Brennan and I both, and other ministers in this chamber as well, will be very aware of some of the issues in some of our more deprived communities around funeral poverty and experience of those people who simply cannot afford to bury their loved ones. And I think I said at stage one of this process that I really feel it is a hallmark of our civilised society that we should have arrangements in place that can afford everyone a dignified funeral, burial or cremation. The fact that some families in the country simply cannot afford those costs is something that I think the next Parliament will need to look very seriously at. I'm glad that the powers over funeral payments are being devolved and that the Cabinet Secretary has commissioned a report on funeral poverty. And I certainly intend, if I'm returned to this Parliament, to work and follow this very closely to make sure that we can make some strides on this in Scotland. And I would commend the Citizens Advice Bureau's work on this, Presiding Officer, because they have highlighted very starkly the issues of funeral poverty across this country. I think it was a very good move today that the government was able to accept my colleague Leslie Brennan's amendment on funeral poverty. But as my colleague said, I think this is just the start of a very important process to really try and eradicate funeral poverty in Scotland. Presiding Officer, Nigel Dawn was left with some of the intricacies surrounding in his convenorship of Delegated Powers Committee. But I think this links back to what I was saying about funeral poverty and licensing scheme and some sort of regulation of funeral directors. I would agree with him that I would prefer these arrangements to be set out in primary legislation rather than regulations. I think it makes for clearer and better law, but I'm glad that the affirmative procedure will help the next Parliament to scrutinise the development of a licensing scheme. But for the reasons I've outlined in combination with the issues around funeral poverty, I think that is going to be very important, and it is a process that we will follow very intensely in the next Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I call on Dr. Nanette Milne. Dr. Milne, 5 minutes, please. Members may wish to note that this is Dr. Milne's valedictory speech. And on behalf of the Parliament, I would like to thank Dr. Milne for her many years of dedicated service to our Parliament. She has been a figure. She has been a figure of honest endeavour and, if I may say so, at times undervalued by even her own party. Dr. Milne, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, for those very kind words. Of the 7 bills dealt with by the Health and Sport Committee during this session of Parliament, 6 of them have been before us during the last 5 or 6 months, and this final Stage 3 debate brings to a close a particularly busy session, which has been quite onerous on committee members, clerks and support staff. And no doubt this applies to ministers and their staff as well. The committee clerks have done a tremendous job and managed to retain their sense of humour even during the most nitpicky changes to their carefully written draft reports, and I greatly admire their tenacity. This bill is a very welcome piece of legislation and much needed, given that the law around burial is well over a century old and no longer fit for purpose in the modern world. And the proposed legislation around cremation should prevent in future the traumas experienced by the many still grieving parents who have no idea what happened to the ashes of their infants and stillborn babies following cremation. It was the discovery in 2012 that cremation authorities in Scotland had different practices for the recovery of ashes from the cremation of babies and the severe distress that this caused to bereaved parents that led to Dame Eilish Angelini's report on the practice at Morton Hall Crematorium and the establishment of the Infant Cremation Commission, chaired by Lord Bonamy, which examined the policies, practices and legislation related to the cremation of babies in Scotland, and whose recommendations in 2014 led to the Voluntary Code of Practice on baby and infant cremations published thereafter, which this bill will make binding on relevant authorities within the funeral industry. There were significant concerns around the drafting of the bill as it was introduced, particularly concerning the large amount of detail left to regulation rather than being on the face of the bill. There will still be a deal of work required by the next Parliament, but significant amendment of the bill at stages 2 and 3 has resulted in a better and stronger piece of legislation. At the last meeting of the Parliament's cross-party group on funerals and bereavement, which I have co-convened for a number of years, there was general consensus that the bill was acceptable and indeed welcome, as amended at stage 2, and no suggestions for further amendment came forward from there ahead of today's stage 3 proceedings. There was agreement that electronic records are needed in this day and age, although there was less willingness to accept the need for licensing of funeral directors, most of whom already follow the code of practice of their national associations, with very few giving the industry a bad name. The agreement to provide guidance on funeral costs will be very welcome, I'm sure, by that group of people. So it would appear, Presiding Officer, that this bill has widespread support from the bereaved and from those responsible for dealing with the burial or cremation of their loved ones. There's a great deal of sensitivity surrounding the issues dealt with in this bill, and I think the Parliament's committees and staff have done their very best to ensure its passage has been dealt with in a mature and sensitive manner. As I said at the outset, the Health and Sport Committee has scrutinised several bills in this Parliament and done a number of other important pieces of work, but we've had no time at all to look at previous legislation. And this lack of post-legislative scrutiny in a unicameral Parliament is something that will have to be considered in future, in my opinion, because a critical appraisal of our work is very important in a Parliament such as ours, particularly when there's a majority government. So, Presiding Officer, as I come to the end of my speaking time in this Parliament, I must acknowledge with gratitude the help and support of so many people who spare no effort in looking after us in this building. Indeed, all the Parliament support staff, including those in security, the Postal Service, the canteen, Queensbury Lounge, Spice, the official report, and many others I have no time to mention. I'd also like to acknowledge the excellent work by yourself, Deputy Presiding Officer, and your colleagues, and that of the committee clerks and my own party's hardworking researchers in our PRU. And I must particularly mention my own team of Miles, Dom and Lindsay, who most of you know, and who have been rocks of support and help for me over the years and who are now more like family than employees. I've enjoyed my contact and friendship with fellow MSPs, both within my own party and across the chamber, and I've particularly enjoyed sharing the health brief with Jackson Carlow, whose astute and witty comments have often enlivened a long Thursday afternoon of debate, and who has quickly absorbed the detail of our health service, which I have lived and breathed for such a long time. Presiding officer, it's been a privilege to represent the great folk of North East Scotland for the past 13 years and to meet the many people I've got to know down here through committee work and the many cross-party groups I'm involved with. But I am looking forward very much to getting back to my long-suffering husband and family, to re-engaging with many friends in Aberdeen and beyond, and to paying a bit more attention to my home and garden. I was reminded last week when I met the late Tom McCabe's widow, showing her young daughter around Parliament, of my maiden speech in 2003. It was in a members' debate on North East dentistry, to which Tom McCabe replied in his role as Health Minister. During the course of his speech, he inadvertently referred to me as Nanette Newman, who was in her day quite a famous film star, though probably not known to the younger members here today. Poor Tom couldn't understand what he'd said to result in such loud laughter all around him, and I dined out at his mistake for quite some time. So today, presiding officer, 13 years on, I think I'm actually the oldest member of this current Parliament, and there is then, therefore, perhaps a degree of irony in the fact that my final contribution is in stage three of the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill, a bill that we will, of course, be supporting this evening. Thank you.
Many thanks. And, of course, we wish you every success in the future. We now move to the open debate speeches. I now call on Bob Doris to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
6 minutes speeches.
Speeches, yes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I enjoyed that valedictory speech from Nanette, although she did have at one point googling Nanette Newman just to double check that I knew who it was. But I do know who it is. Unfortunately, I'm not that young. I just wanted to check that I was right. And can I thank Nanette for all her hard, diligent work on the Health Committee, which she sat on with myself for a number of years now, and I very much appreciate the constructive and partnership approach that she's taken to that, and wish her the very, very best for the many years of her retirement that she has left out with this place, back to the real world, I suspect, rather than the bubble of Holyrood. So best wishes to Nanette for her retirement. Can I also, when we're doing thank yous, thank all the witnesses that gave evidence to the Health and Sport Committee, across a range of committees that took evidence in relation to this bill, but I suppose most of all to the families that I and other MSPs have met with, who came forward bravely and fiercely and diligently to make their voices heard in relation to whether there was shortcomings in relation to the service they were due, they should have expected and should have had delivered to them at some of the most horrific experiences in their life, where the organisational framework, and they were let down by that and by people who failed in their service to them. So thank you to the parents who have came forward to help shape this bill we have before us this morning. I'd written down a few words in relation to what I thought this was about for myself. And for me, it's about bereavement and loss as much as it is about anything else. That's the thread that runs through all this. And it's when you suffer that bereavement and loss, it's about feeling control, knowing that there's transparency in the process that then faces you, that there's certainty in relation to that, that there's compassion along the way, and there's sensitivity and flexibility to deal with that loss in the way that you see fit, and that you have that choice. And there's the expectation at the bottom of it all, and that's the expectation that when you lose a loved one, that you choose how their remains are best remembered, and that there will be ashes should you wish them. And it is said that 99.9% of the time we should be expecting ashes for loved ones when they pass away, and this bill should make sure that happens all the time. The legislation that underpinned this was archaic. It was fragmented. It was poor. It was shoddy, quite frankly. And I think the Stage 3 legislation we have before us today provides a coherent and statutory framework in relation to taking forward a modern way of dealing with these tragic events when they do happen. I made an intervention on the Minister at one of the amendments at stage 3 in relation to section 54A, which the Minister quite rightly said the amendment wasn't particularly in reference to, but I wanted to make the point about pregnancy loss upon pregnancy loss is expected to occur, because I believe one of the powerful aspects of this legislation will be to expect higher standards of care right across the NHS when expectant mothers lose their babies, whether that's before or after 24 weeks of pregnancy, that they will be given the choices that too often that they have been denied. And I said before during my contribution during the amendment that for many mums, and it's just the tragedy of pregnancy loss, are sometimes sent home and told, you know, you can expect a miscarriage or a pregnancy loss in the next week or so, and having to deal with the pain and the grief that surrounds that. And what this bit of legislation, what Sections 54A does, is it affords those mums some of the same choice, power, protection and control that others going through such a horrific experience also have and should always have had. I think we do have to build upon this bill, and we have to look at the continuum of loss and bereavement, whether that is in old age or in pregnancy. And we have to draw this right down to recurrent miscarriage and early pregnancy loss, and how we deal with the mental health of expecting mums in relation to that, and how we support the families in relation to that, and how we make sure when they lose their unborn children that we deal with that loss in a very sensitive way that gives them the maximum amount of choice. And the NHS hasn't really always got that right. The final thing I'd like to say, maybe, Presiding Officer, is that the other thing I got from this, we can legislate any way we like in this Parliament. The key aspect of this issue is about empathy, respect and dignity, and the conversation that people have, whether that is NHS staff having conversations with mums who experience loss, whether that is funeral directors having that empathy and compassion and those discussions they have with families of experienced loss. And you can't quite legislate for that. You have to hope the human condition makes that happen in a positive and constructive way. But what we can legislate for is the framework that underpins all of that. And I hope in the years ahead we do better than we have done in the past.
Many thanks. And before we proceed any further, I should apologise to Parliament for having inadvertently misled you. We are expecting 4-minute speeches in this debate, but there is quite a bit of time in hand, so it will be a generous 4-minute speeches. I now call on Malcolm Chisholm to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
The Office can also pay tribute to Nanette Milne for the massive contribution she has made on health and other issues during her 13 years in the Parliament, and say how much I've enjoyed working with her for several years as joint conveners of the cross-party group on cancer. Since this is the sixth health bill that I've dealt with during my 6 months on the Health Committee, I think I would also like to take this opportunity to say thank you for the last time to the wonderful clerks of the Health Committee, and also to the always helpful members of the Legislative and Delegated Power Team in the Parliament. Now, this is not my last speech, but like Nanette Milne, I did think that the cremation bill might be a suitable topic for an older person myself. But while it is the prerogative of an older person to look towards death in a realistic and light-hearted way, that is certainly not the situation for any parent losing a child. And of course, in the context of this bill, that means also infant loss, stillbirth and pregnancy loss. That has to be the most devastating experience that anyone could suffer. And if anyone doubts that, they would only need to listen to the evidence that we heard. And I thank all the people who gave evidence to us on the record, but also sans Lothian parents who gave evidence, certainly to Nanette Milne and myself, and I think one other member of the Health Committee in a private session. Now, there was a great deal of discussion in that and other evidence sessions about ashes, and some people have said, I've even heard people say, well, what difference did the ashes make? But if we listen to the parents, We know how important that is. Once we listen, we can begin to empathise, the word that Bob Doris used a moment ago, empathise with those parents. And in the committee, I raised the issue of ashes, for example. I suggested amendments about having words about the expectations that ashes will be recovered, and also that the processes and equipment in crematoriums should be dealt with in regulation, and that we should always insist that the maximum amount of ashes will be recovered. And I pay tribute to the Minister because I think she reassured me at committee in terms of the codes of practice covering those issues. And I also notice Amendment 74 today is about regulations about the operation of equipment for the carrying out of cremation. So I think those matters have been dealt with by the government. I was also reassured, of course, earlier about women being at the centre of decision-making in relation to ashes, and I think we're all united now in feeling that the bill does that in a satisfactory way. Of course, there are issues which are not in the bill and perhaps cannot be in the bill, and one issue that was raised by the Sands Lothian parents in private session was the whole issue about the training of staff, and this is clearly very crucial in terms of relating to parents, mothers in particular, in this situation. And they recommended, for example, specialist roles in midwifery, maternity and bereavement services, and that's, I hope, something that the government will look at. But of course, it's not just health staff relating to patients that perhaps we think about, because it's also a matter of us as politicians relating to parents in this situation. And as I've thought about the bill and the issues in it, it's made me reflect about politicians in general and the need for politicians to have empathy with people that they're discussing matters with, firstly in order to respond appropriately as, to the individuals that we meet, but also in terms of the policies and legislation that we develop. And in fact, as I come to the end of my political career, although not my political involvement, it seems to me that empathy is the most important quality that a politician can have. So I support the bill, including today's amendments. There were quite a lot of them, but as someone who introduced more than 1,000 amendments to the final stage of the mental health bill, I am no position to complain about late amendments.
Many thanks. I now call Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
First of all, could I also pay tribute to Dr. Nanette Milne? Over the years, we have agreed, we have disagreed, we have agreed to disagree. But I don't think that there has been any malice when we have disagreed. Dr. Milne's service, not only in this Parliament, but in councils beforehand, has been a great thing for Aberdeen, in my opinion. And I wish her and her husband, Alan, all the best for the future. I'm sure that she will keep him very busy indeed. Presiding Officer, we have scrutinised this burials and cremations bill to a great degree. And I think there are a number of things which are within this bill which makes things much better than they were previously. Inspectors, I think, are to be welcomed. The introduction of a licensing regime for funeral directors is certainly a good thing, in my opinion. And things like the reuse of layers have been a long time coming. But there are other things which I think are also important. And although they didn't feature very highly in some of the contributions that have been made thus far, I think the recording of things has got to be improved. We're seeing that through this bill. I know that Willie Coffey, during the course of the local government deliberations, mentioned these things a lot and contributed a great deal. And I think that we are going to end up with a much better system in that regard after this bill is passed. Presiding Officer, Fraser Sutherland of Citizens Advice Scotland told the Local Government Committee that Citizens Advice Scotland had seen a 35% increase in the number of clients concerned about funeral issues and affordability. During the course of our evidence at the Local Government Committee, we've seen a huge difference in costs in various places. For example, the purchase of a lair and the cost of an internment is £694 in the Western Isles, but £2,785 in East Dumbartonshire. That's quite an astronomical figure. In terms of cremation and the scattering of ashes, the cost in Inverclyde is £512 for a local authority cremation. It's £749 in Perth and Kinross. And in terms of private cremations, it's £585 in Paisley, but £830 in Moray. And I'm pleased that that the government has agreed to organise a national funeral poverty conference and roundtable discussions between ministers and stakeholders to look at this and to promote action. I think that as the funeral payments powers are devolved, now is the right time to look at all of these issues, because, as others have said, people do struggle with paying for the funerals of loved ones, and I think we must do all that we can to ensure that we get that right. Presiding Officer, this bill looked at a huge number of issues, and we've seen this morning that one of the controversial ones that was discussed was that distance between a crematorium and housing. I think that we need to look at the planning guidance. I don't think it's just housing that is the problem, as I said earlier on. If you're going to have limitations, that should include commercial property too. But we have also got to look at where we are at the present moment. And as I said earlier, we have a crematorium here in Edinburgh where there is housing right on the doorstep. And if there was an application to reconstruct or refurbish that crematorium, if we had passed Mr. Wilson's amendment, if we'd agreed to Mr. Wilson's amendment, that would have been extremely difficult indeed. And I do think that we have to trust planning authorities to look at this very carefully, take into account local circumstances, and to act accordingly. Presiding Officer, this is an issue that probably requires more than a four-minute speech, but since that's all I have today, I would say thank you very much, and I hope that we will agree to pass this legislation at decision time today.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart, but you actually got five. Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I, like others, join in the tributes paid to Nanette Milne today for her valedictory speech, but also for her service to the Parliament. She's always thoughtful and considered in her responses, and someone I think everybody listens to, so she'll be greatly missed, but I'm sure, knowing the way this place works, she'll be back in touch and giving us the benefit of her thoughts and ideas as we go forward, or those of us who hope to go forward. And this might be a valedictory speech for more than we hope. Can I also thank the witnesses that give evidence to the committee? Some, I think, give evidence in very difficult circumstances, and I would like to pay tribute to them, as well as all those who supported the committee. This bill is trying to put safeguards in place to stop terrible things happening, such as the baby ashes scandal, and make sure that they never happen again. However, it also makes us look at the way in which we view death, and there is, of course, the temptation to take as much pressure off the bereaved person as possible. And it's understandable that that's even more so when the bereavement is unexpected, because such loss feels unbearable. We seek to make decisions for them in order to make things easier. However, this can cause problems because disposal of remains has very strong rituals attached, sometimes cultural issues, and very often bound by a religious belief. It's also the last thing we can do for a loved one, and it's important where possible to have their wishes at the heart of the process, where they're able to express them, and also the wishes of close family. And where this is a pregnancy loss or a stillbirth, it's important to involve the mother in decision making at a pace and at a time that is in her best interests. Organising a funeral, interment or cremation are rituals that force people to continue through their grief, provide them with a focus and make sure that the send-off is fitting, and that can bring them comfort in the long term. However, if things are not done in accordance to their wishes, it can add to the distress of the bereaved. Therefore, while sensitivity is required, so is the provision of information and choices. We see with the disposal of baby ashes the distress caused when parents were not informed or involved, and there's no way of easing that suffering. All we can do is make sure it never happens again. Amendments have been made which put matters very much in the hands of the mother, not allowing assumptions to be made about her wishes, and that's what went wrong in the past. Whatever guidance goes with this bill, it needs to emphasise that the wishes of the bereaved need to be sought and implemented. I was a member of the Health and Sport Committee, and while we maybe dealt with some of those very difficult issues, it was the other committee that dealt with the more contentious parts of the bill. The siting of crematoriums and their distance from housing is important. Too close to housing and you're likely to have parking and noise problems for those attending the crematorium, and also likely to have parking congestion for housing, and indeed traffic disruption, which might be dangerous to young children and families living close by. I agree that it should be common sense to ensure that they are a reasonable distance apart, but we know that with planning, common sense does not always prevail. And I sincerely hope that the Scottish Government don't rue the day that they remove that prescription of distance from the bill. Very briefly.
Kevin Stewart.
Is Rhoda Grant, presiding officer, saying that she doesn't trust councillors to make common sense decisions in these regards?
Rosie Grant.
The next time I hear Kevin Stewart complaining about a council planning decision, I'll remind him of his words. I think we've all been aware of council planning decisions where we haven't agreed and maybe has gone in the face of what the local community wish. The other issue touched upon in amendments today is the cost of funerals. And the costs have increased a huge amount. Some of these are due to local government cuts. The Scottish Government have starved local government of funding, leaving them with no choice but to increase costs where they have the ability to charge. And this isn't right. People are already distressed by their bereavement and have the worry of how they're likely to afford to bury or cremate their loved one on top of that. Speed and costs don't leave people with choices, often forcing them to take the cheapest option, which might not be their preferred option. Presiding officer, we need to talk about dying and death, providing family and friends with the information they need to make choices about burial and cremation. We also need to make sure that those who do not or cannot make those choices for themselves are represented by close relatives, and that they in turn are supported through this very difficult time.
Many thanks. I now call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Leslie Brennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I, like others, welcome this bill and anticipate its passage come decision time. Burials and cremations are, of course, a very important part of most people's lives. We will make individual decisions about what we want to happen after our own deaths, but it is for those who come after to discharge them. For my part, I hope there is neither a burial nor, in particular, a cremation. It would be awfully nice if my pals got together and celebrated a little bit of my life, perhaps, but I'm in a tiny minority who wishes my remains to be disposed of for the benefit of anybody who can find anything useful to do with them. And of course, different societies make different decisions. I visited the remains of Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov in Red Square in 1972. I visited the embalmed remains of Mao Zedong in Beijing in 1978. But in our culture, the history has been that burials are the important thing, with cremations following on rather later. And the important thing is that it gives those who are left behind to grieve a sense of connection to a place. And that seems to be the most important thing that there is around this. That's why it's very important that part of the bill makes it a legal duty on the local authorities to publish where people are buried. that enables that sense of connection to be continued over the generations, if that's what we want. For my own part, because of my genealogical research I've done over 50 years, I'm still discovering connections of place. It's only been 3 years since I discovered that one of my father's cousins actually died in Queensberry House. It was in 1970 when she died. It was actually a nursing home, so that wasn't particularly unreasonable. So therefore, I have that connection and find that interesting. And in the last year, I've discovered three members of my extended family who are actually buried in the new Carlton Kirkyard out the back. And that sense of connection is what we're what we are discussing in this bill. And in looking at the issue of ashes, and in particular those of the youngsters or those who have not survived to be born, there's a particular poignancy associated with those remains, their disposal, and the connection of those who experience loss to the location of where those remains will end up. And I think this bill does a great deal to set a future where people will not suffer the emotional turmoil that they suffered in the past. Let me congratulate Leslie Brennan, our most recent Member of the Parliament, for persuading the government to accept her amendment. Having spent quite a few years in opposition, I know that's not the easiest of things to achieve, so I think she deserves our congratulation. But then that just simply illustrates that if sensible things are brought forward, the option is always there to persuade people. And at the other end of the scale, the mother of the house departs us shortly. I've sat beside Nanette Milne at many occasions when she hasn't felt at her most comfortable. I think in particular when she's deputised for Alec Johnson at farmers' events, I've felt her discomfort. I see her nodding slightly, so that's certainly true. But the fact that she's done so, I think, shows how she's never shrinked from undertaking the duties that come with elected office. And like others, I wish her well in what we will describe as retirement, but I suspect more properly it should simply be another part of her life. Finally, Presiding Officer, I made reference at a previous stage of life, and this is something we have to deal with when we consider succession, that one of the enduring mysteries for me in all this is that I can decide how my house is to be disposed of, the money in my bank account, my possessions. But as the person who might be newly deceased, I have no say over the disposal of my remains. That is utterly left to my relatives. And I think that is unfinished business in this policy area. Although, of course, it is always an area where there is checks and balances and difficulties to be considered when we look at that, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Leslie Brennan to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The material covered in this bill, as everyone said, is very sensitive and covers many very sensitive topics. And I've focused on funeral poverty due to my experience as a local councillor, but also, as I mentioned at a previous stage, a close friend's experience. And I think what's been mentioned a few times about empathy, I think as politicians we ought to be able to empathise and actually try to understand how we best could serve the people that we're here to represent. I was really pleased that the Minister has adopted and supported the amendment that I put forward, especially given the welfare state's cradle-to-grave philosophy and in the light of rising funeral costs and an ageing population. And I'm also pleased that the Minister made reference to the academic work that I highlighted at stage two for doctors Christine Valentine and Kate Woodthrop at the Centre for Death and Society at the University of Bath. Having communicated with them, I know that they are keen to share their knowledge to help eradicate funeral poverty in Scotland. So I hope in the next session that those who are working in this area will make use of their work and expertise. It's accepted that funeral costs may impose considerable financial burden on those left behind. and burden not only reflects that funeral costs are subject to market forces, but also that bereavement in itself may cause financial hardship. The situation is compounded by death being perceived as a private and highly individualised event, accompanied by a lack of a widespread culture of preparing for death. So with increasing funeral poverty, important implications for existing and potential future demand for local authorities has been flagged up as an issue. So these public health funerals, which are often referred to as sort of a pauper's funeral, I think we need to actually look at why there's increasing demand, and obviously it's funeral poverty. And I will look to the next government and the next parliament to fully address the social fund funeral payment scheme, because it's just not working at the minute. There's usually, if you get about £1,300 funeral payment, but the actual cost of the funeral being £3,500. And therefore, when people have no choice, they're then left to go to the local authority, or in the case that I raised in stage one, a case of my friend who was advised not to claim his mother's body, so that person then would be left, so that his mother would be left to the state for a state funeral. That's just not good enough in Scotland today. He was left with that shame of not being able to give his mother the funeral that he wanted. So I really do hope that the next parliament addresses this issue fully. So my amendment, and I recognise it's a really modest amendment, it's just about guidance on funeral costs, but it will help to illuminate how to help grieving families keep the costs down and at the same time give their loved ones a final send-off with dignity. And as Rhoda Grant has stated, to give a dignified send-off gives those who are grieving some comfort. And obviously, as the guidance states, before issuing such guidance, there's a duty on the Scottish Government to consult burial authorities, cremation authorities, funeral directors, and any other person they wish to consider appropriate. So I was really glad that the Government has supported the amendment, because it is a reasonable amendment. It's very similar in structure to Section 20 of the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. And it's, when this bill passes tonight, if everyone supports it, the Parliament will take one step on the pathway of eradicating funeral poverty. I think finally I want to say thank you to the Parliament's clerking team, who've helped me as a very newbie shape an amendment. They've been so supportive, so I just want to note just my appreciation for the clerking team. So thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Richard Lyle to be followed by John Wilson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin my remarks in the Chamber today, this morning, by saying how delighted I am to speak in this important debate on Burials Cremation Scotland Bill, particularly as a member of the Parliament's Health and Sport Committee. To Nanette Milne, I wish you well. It's been an absolute pleasure to have worked with you in the committee, and you're actually younger than Nanette Newman, some 8 years younger, so don't say you're an oldie, you aren't. I'd also like to take the opportunity to wish my other retiring colleagues, past and present, on the Health Committee all the very best in their retirement, and to say how much it's been a pleasure to work with them over the years in the course of this Parliament. Presiding Officer, there have been a number of bills that the Health Committee has dealt with over the years. Evidence taken on this bill was the most heart-rending. I want to focus the attention of my remarks today on the important matter of this legislation. The bill before Parliament today will do well to modernise the legislative framework for burials and cremations here in Scotland. At present, our existing legislation on burial and cremations dates back some 100 years, and we see each day that it's been becoming increasingly unfit for purpose in our modern Scotland. Now, I do not wish to deliver a history lesson. I think Mr Stevenson does that quite ably to Parliament. But it is important to note that the law on burials is set in the Burial Grounds Scotland Act 1855, and it's not been substantially revised since the 19th century. And turning to our laws on cremation, which were set out in the 1902 Cremation Act and amended and regulated through other pieces of legislation. In short, the picture I want to paint before this Parliament today is that our current and existing legislation is fragmented, dated, and is increasingly unable to meet the needs of Scottish society. It is right, therefore, that today we refresh and modernise existing provisions which are relevant to today's society and combine these with a new provision which will create legislation fit for a modern and 21st century Scotland. I am aware that I don't have a lot of time in this debate, Presiding Officer, and therefore I wish to choose to reflect on two particular strands of the bill before Parliament. I want to look at the ability of this bill to deliver on many of the recommendations made in the Infant Cremation Commission report. The report, established by Scottish ministers in April 2013, was in response to historical practices at some crematoriums in Scotland and in relation to the cremation of babies and to address serious public concern. The majority of the Commission recommendations focused on providing a more consistent and robust process for applying for a cremation of pregnancy losses in babies. The recommendations were made to remove ambiguity about the extent of which the current legal process for cremation applies to pregnancy losses. Among other recommendations were that the application process should be strengthened so that applicants are given as much opportunity as possible to consider the implications of various methods of disposal before making a final decision. The Minister, Maureen Watt, has already outlined that this bill has a number of provisions that address the issues identified by Lord Bonamy and will ensure that we never make the mistakes of the past. Presiding Officer, in the time I have remaining, I'd also like to look at the issue of burials. One of the resounding areas of this bill is that it will support burial authorities in the management of their burial grounds. As you already know, Presiding Officer, all burial authorities already manage and maintain burial grounds, but there are currently no single source of guidance on this, which causes uncertainty over what actions can be taken in certain circumstances. In particular, there is lack of clarity over what actions can be taken to make safe headstones and memorials. As a consequence of the Scottish Government's consultation with burial authorities, it was found that the regulations would be beneficial. Therefore, this bill serves to clarify and provides a duty on burial authorities to ensure the safety of burial grounds. In closing, Presiding Officer, I am proud to see another piece of legislation before this Parliament that seeks to deliver for our modern and 21st century Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks. The final open debate speaker is John Wilson.
Sir, I'd also like to put on record my thanks to Dr Nanette Milne in terms of her quiet words, particularly when we served on the Public Petitions Committee together. It's always been a pleasure to work with Nanette in relation to the sage advice, I think is appropriate to say, in relation to the comments and in the passing in the corridor. Presiding Officer, today we'll pass a bill and which will become an act, and members will have heard my concerns earlier about one part of the bill that I think we missed out on an opportunity to modernise, as many witnesses and others indicated we should, as a committee and as a Parliament try and do, to make sure that the bill and the act is fit for the 21st century. I'd also like to say that in terms of the advice we received, the comments, the submissions and the oral evidence, that clearly there were some issues raised by those local authorities in particular about the retention of some type of buffer zone between crematoria and residential properties. And I wait with interest in relation to the Minister's assurance that Scottish planning policy will result in guidance that will be issued to local authorities. But as others have indicated, and Rhoda Branken indicated earlier, the concern that I have is while we have guidance in the Scottish planning policy, that too often that guidance seems to be overturned in relation to the decisions not made by local authorities who try to follow the guidance, but by others above local authorities. And local authorities that spend 3 years carrying out local plan consultation exercises with local communities to find that after the three-year process, that local plan is totally ignored when it comes to housing development proposals by the Scottish Government, ministers and DPEA. So I would like to think, when the Minister takes this back to her colleagues, that she takes on board the issue about ensuring that guidance applies to all when they consider the way forward. Can I say that my congratulations to Leslie Brennan in getting the perseverance and getting their amendment through today and acceptance by the Scottish Government on those amendments? Because I think it is important that we address fuel poverty, funeral poverty, sorry, and fuel poverty as well is equally important. But when we took evidence at the committee, we heard the costs of some of the burials that take place around Scotland. And we heard that in terms of the most expensive was Eastern Bartonshire Council, with the cost of a layer and interment at £2,785. And the cheapest Western Isles at £694. When you get these types of costs presented to you, and then you hear and you read that local authorities are increasing these costs by 15% this year, then you realise the importance and the urgency that the Minister's working group has to take forward this issue as a matter of concern, because we need to get something in place that does not lead to a situation, as Leslie Brennan indicated, where we have people who are not able to go and claim a family member's body because of the fear of having to pay the difference in the costs, funeral costs. We also heard that evidence at committee from a chaplain from the Scottish Prison Service, where people die in prison and family members are not encouraged to claim the body because they will be liable for the costs of the funeral or the cremation. And that is, in this 21st century society, to say to individuals that, no, it's better not to claim your loved one's body because you may be actually put into further financial hardship. Presiding officer, I think tonight we will be voting for this bill and see it come into act. But as I said, with the caveats that I've mentioned, the Minister hopefully will take forward the concerns that have been raised today and ensure that we do not look forward to a situation where the demand for land or the barriers to be eroded between crematoria for housing is one that we actually find developers chapping on the door of local authorities and others to actually erode that further. Thank you very much indeed, President.
Many thanks. We now turn to closing speeches. I invite the two colleagues who have participated and who are missing to return to the chamber, please. And I call on Jackson Carlaw. Maximum 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This bill is a contract between this Parliament and the parents of those children or babies who reacted with anguish, bewilderment, astonishment and dismay earlier in this Parliament, when they found out what the fate had been of the remains of those babies. It was impossible not to be enormously affected, as I know members from all parties across this chamber were, by the very personal testament that we experienced at that time. And it led in this chamber to Eilish Angelini and to Lord Bonamy's recommendations to the voluntary arrangements that Nanette Milne detailed in her speech earlier, and finally to the bill today. And although I think the Minister would accept that much of what we have passed today has been quite technical in nature and the way that we have had to progress it, the parents, some of whom were sitting in the gallery earlier on this morning as we discussed those amendments and held and opened the earlier section of this debate, should be assured that actually the effect of this bill today will realise the very powerful demand that I think they made of us to ensure that we passed legislation that ensured that the situation that occurred would never happen again. And I think we can be proud of the fact that this legislation will achieve that, even as we ourselves acknowledge with dismay ourselves that it proved to be necessary, and that beneath the surface in so many areas of public life, something turns up which really does prove to be astonishing in the modern era, and something that we all kind of in many ways would have imagined was otherwise being addressed. Within the context of the debate, I thought that the key exchange that was of interest was over the designated location and boundary between a crematorium and adjacent properties. And I was minded to support the Minister. I thought John Wilson's contribution was very powerful, but I have to say to Kevin Stewart that his unfettered, unblinking and unquestioning belief in the planning process in our local councils, which I have to say in my own case can quite often cheerfully ignore even elected councillors, if they even bother to let those councillors have a say, so many planning processes are now automatic, will have provoked hoots of derision the length and breadth of the country. I know it was well-intentioned. Maybe they do things differently up there with the folks, as Kevin likes to refer to them. Kevin Stewart likes to refer to them in Aberdeen, old Aberdeen. But I can tell you elsewhere, I'm not just so persuaded that that faith will be rewarded.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I know that we all get upset from time to time about planning decisions, but I think in cases like these, sensitive cases like these, councillors normally act wisely. And I think that we have also got to take into account the things like Edinburgh, where there already is housing next to a crematorium. If there's a reapplication to refurbish that crematorium, would it be rejected out of hand if Mr Wilson's amendment had passed? And the answer to that would have been yes.
Jackson Carlow.
And as Kevin Stewart himself there said, normally act wisely, which absolutely underlines the point that there must be occasions when they do not. And Mr Wilson's amendment, which simply sought to ensure that the provisions which existed in the ancient Act would carry on, I think was a perfectly sensible. However, I do want to finish my remarks today by commenting on party members. I'd like to say if Malcolm Chisholm, whose contributions over the years that I've been in Parliament and watched him, have always, on every occasion, given me pause for thought. They have very often challenged the conceptions I have. Very often they have reinforced them on subsequent consideration. But I have always admired his tenacity and fluency in identifying very often, and I thought even the amendments he didn't press today, issues which might otherwise have escaped the attention of Parliament, and to develop an argument around about them, which, as I say, has always given Parliament pause for thought and I think helped to inform our debates all the more so for that. And I certainly will miss him from this Parliament in the next session if I'm fortunate enough to be here myself. I turn now, of course, to my colleague Nanette Newman. Now, until I'd met Nanette Newman, I'd never met a Nanette before. I had never come across a Nanette. The only Nanettes I covered, Dame Nanette de Valois, I seem to remember, was some ghastly old ballerina that used to stamp a stick in the television in some odd programme or two. And Nanette Newman, who I knew was married to a film director called Brian Forbes and appeared in a lot of dreadful movies, is my recollection. I seem to remember suffering some awful thing called International Velvet with my sister when I was younger. But she was most famous to me for being the person who, what was it, the hands that are do dishes are as soft as you please with mild green. That was my recollection of Nanette Newman on the television. So there we are. And before that, the only other Nanette I'd ever known was No Nanette, the 1925 musical, which had in it the songs Tea for Two and I Want to Be Happy. And I'm very autosuggestive. So every time I have seen Nanette during the last 9 years in Parliament, the songs Tea for Two, I Want to Be Happy, and The Hands That Do Dishes have gone through my mind. But I have to say, she has been a persistent and, I think, a superb member of this Parliament. On health, of course, she has had the advantages of being a medical doctor. She also, of course, has a son who is with her now because of an organ donation and has spoken powerfully on those issues too. I certainly wish her well. Mr Stevenson should be reassured her discomfort was not that Mr Johnson wasn't there. It was because she's so mild-mannered and polite that the savaging Mr Stevenson was getting from the farmers left her slightly uncomfortable, and that must have been the emotion that he witnessed on that occasion. I certainly look forward to staying in touch with Annette. We've worked together since John Major invited us both to be a party vice chairman over 25 years ago. She's given great service to this Parliament, and I know that she and Alan will have a long and happy retirement, to which I wish them every success and happiness. Presiding officer.
Thank you. I now call on Jenny Mara. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to use this opportunity, especially since I'm speaking twice this morning, to pay tribute to some of my colleagues who are leaving as well. And I'd like to follow several members this morning in paying tribute to Nanette Milne. It's only for the past year or so that I have worked as I've been on the health brief for a relatively short period, but I have felt great warmth from Nanette in the meetings, both in this Parliament and outside in NHS Tayside and in other forums. And I hope she has a very long and very happy retirement from this place. I was also reflecting just how, with a woman stepping down from Parliament, you know, the example that women in this Parliament have given me in stepping into this role for the first time over the past 5 years. And I think there is an added, perhaps not burden, but certainly added responsibility or certain pressure of being a woman in elected politics. And I think people like Nanette bear that with great fortitude and dignity and a good example to us all. Presiding Officer, if I may also mark, because this week as Parliament dissolves, 3 very special colleagues of mine on the Labour benches will also not be seeking re-election to this place. And I know that Duncan McNeill made his last speech in this chamber on the Scotland Bill last week, but I think in this health debate it may be appropriate to pay tribute to him, because as health convener for the past 5 years, he has paid assiduous attention to the health of the NHS across this country. But I always feel with Duncan very a very insightful and grounded analysis of how decisions in this place affect constituents and the people that he represents. I think he has made a great service to this chamber, this Parliament, and its development over the last 16 years, and I know that he will be missed. Likewise, with my colleague Hugh Henry, whose, I think, sense of humour and wit in this Parliament will be dearly missed. These are giants, I think, of our first 16 years of this devolved Parliament. But, Presiding Officer, if I may, I would like to pay a very special tribute to a dear friend and colleague of mine, Malcolm Chisholm, who this is the last debate I will participate in with Malcolm. Since I stepped into this building 5 years ago, Malcolm has been the most supportive, inspirational and empathetic mentor that I think any young politician could hope for. And he has, I think, taken a very special care of myself and our Scottish Labour leader, Kezia Dugdale, and we will both be forever indebted to that. I always sense when we're having debates in this chamber that I know myself that I feel reassured and more confident when Malcolm is taking part in these debates with his attention to detail. And I sense from the government benches that they always feel the same. He will be very greatly missed in this place. Presiding Officer, can I turn to some of the contributions this afternoon? I think I summarised most earlier, but I was particularly taken by Kevin Stewart's very thoughtful reflection on this bill today. Some of the things he mentioned, the welcomed inspection regime, the reuse of layers, which I think is very welcome and particularly important, and the licensing of funeral directors. And as I said in my opening speech, I think that will be very important on the whole issue of funeral poverty to watch very closely going forward. And Kevin Stewart took the opportunity to really highlight Citizens Advice Scotland's figures and the geographical disparity on the cost of funeral, which I think really gives great weight and evidence to the case that my colleague Leslie Brennan brought today about funeral poverty, and the 35% increase he highlighted in inquiries about affordability, I think is particularly stark, and also the geographical differences in cost that he talked about. Kevin's contribution, presiding officer, also made me reflect on a constituent representation that I had on this very issue, that insurance policies for funerals that have been paid into for many, many years, some couples and people have been paying into insurance policies to cover their funerals for many years, but they are falling short of the actual costs of funerals when the funeral bill actually comes in, leaving the family to cover the rest. I think insurance policies is probably an issue for regulation at the European Union, but I wonder if it can be addressed in the summit that the government is holding that Kevin Stewart referred to, along with the payment issue, the welfare payment that my colleague Leslie Brennan referred to, the £1,300 payment that is made, which goes no way to meeting the average cost of a funeral at £3,500. And there's also, as we know, MSPs having had representations on this, there's an issue with the timing of these payments as well, whether they're going to be approved by the Department of Work and Pensions, whether the funeral directors can then rely on that when the application is still in process. But I'm sure that all of these issues will be discussed at the summit and in the commission that the Cabinet Secretary, Alec Neil, has commissioned. Can I close by saying, presiding officer, that I always enjoy, through the passage of this bill, Stuart Stevenson's contributions, and I think the points he made today about records on burials perhaps add a lighter but a cultural and a very important note to this debate, because it is about knowing our place, our ancestors, where they were buried, and being able to track and record that, not just for companies in this country that can, you know, that can stretch abroad and make business through genealogy, but also for people doing their own family tree and our own sense of place and belonging in this country. I think it's a very appropriate thing to end on and a very appropriate place for this bill. Scottish Labour Party is delighted to support this bill tonight.
Many thanks. I now call in Maureen Watt to wind up the debate. Minister, 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, presiding officer. And I'd like to thank all members for their contribution to this debate. Throughout the bill's progress, there has been strong support for the principles of the bill, and I'm grateful to members for the quality of the contributions they've made, not only this morning, but previously, as this bill has passed through Parliament. I'd like to thank again the committees who have dealt with this bill. It's always difficult taking a bill through when it is in front of two committees, but I think the Health and Sport Committee and the Local Government Regeneration Committee have done a good job with this bill. And I'd like to thank the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and Nigel Dawn for his detailed look at bills. Nigel has brought a specific insight into the working of this Parliament and has always had a slightly different take on bills as they have gone through Parliament, and I thank him for that. And I'd like to also pay tribute to Duncan McNeill as convener of the Health and Support Committee and his thoughtful way in which he has dealt with witnesses and ministers coming in front of the committee. I had a bit of a tear in my eye when he spoke on the Scotland Bill Committee report, the LCM, last week in his final speech. I'd also like to thank the bill team for their support and the stakeholders who have helped in the construction of this bill. I'd like to particularly thank Simon Cuthbert Kerr, who has lived and breathed this bill for months and months. I'm sure he wakes up thinking about this bill, but now he'll be able to get his life back and get back to playing in his band, which he does so well. Can I also, Malcolm Chisholm has said that it's still not his final speech in this Parliament, but I'd like to pay tribute to all the work he has done in both this Parliament and the other place he too has had a very colourful and distinguished career in politics, and I commend him for that. I'd also like to say that I too will miss Nanette Milne, not just on the train up to Aberdeen on a Thursday night that we have shared on many occasions, but the number of cross-party groups on health that there are in this Parliament exceeds all expectations, I think, and Nanette has done our utmost to try and represent the Conservative Party on so many of them. Nanette and I have worked at local council level on Grampian Region and district level, and Nanette has made a huge contribution to political life in the North East. I'm sure I'll still see her because her son lives quite near me, and I'm sure Nanette will continue her interest in the arts scene in the North East. But I too wish you and Alan a happy retirement. Presiding Officer, there can be no doubt that the bill makes some much-needed changes to the burial and cremation processes. I believe that the bill would create a legislative framework for burial and cremation that will meet the needs of 21st century Scotland. It will remove the inconsistency that is apparent currently and make processes easier to understand and more reliable. When we are arranging a funeral, we should be able to expect a straightforward and transparent process that makes the process easier, not more difficult, and I think the bill will provide that. Many of the topics in the bill are extremely sensitive. As the bill has made its way through Parliament, we have heard from people who have experienced loss in unimaginable circumstances, and these experiences alone should be reason for us to address the shortcomings in the current system. And Bob Dorris made an important point about health professionals and others dealing sensitively with pregnancy loss at whatever stage it occurs. In particular, the new processes put in place in relation to pregnancy losses and stillbirth will address many of the issues identified by Lord Bonamy, as both Rhoda Grant and Richard Lyle mentioned in their speeches. It's really important to prevent a repeat of previous mistakes, and I believe the bill will achieve that. And of course, this is in no way the end of the process, as Dame Eilish Angelini has still to report on some of the mishandlings of ashes at crematoria throughout Scotland. Throughout the bill's passage, much has been said about the role of funeral directors. Although it is possible to organise a funeral without using a funeral director, in the majority of cases, people turn to funeral directors for their expertise and experiences. And it must be said that in the majority of cases, funeral directors provide a high-quality service. But we are all aware, as in our constituency cases, of poor service and high costs, which can be difficult to understand. And it's important that we can rely on funeral directors when we have to. And the bill does allow ministers to introduce a licensing scheme for funeral directors that would help establish basic criteria to operate as a funeral director and prevent those who have failed to meet standards from operating as a funeral director. The new inspection powers will bring a level of scrutiny to funeral directors, indeed to the funeral industry as a whole, that has never been seen in Scotland. I'm confident that this will drive up standards and consistency, helping people to know that they will receive the same level of care and service from all parts of the industry. But before the Scottish Government commits to licensing funeral directors, it's important that we better understand the current state of the industry, and this will make sure that any scheme that is introduced will reflect best practice and address specific concerns. And I intend to use the inspectors appointed under the bill to monitor the industry and make recommendations about licensing. There's also been much debate during the passage of the bill about funeral costs. The bill is likely to influence costs to a great degree, for example, requiring local authorities to publish all costs relating to burial and cremation, and this will help improve transparency. It is also likely that the introduction of inspection and potential introduction of licensing for funeral directors will help improve transparency and the consistency of costs. And at this stage, Presiding Officer, I'd like to pay tribute to the work that Leslie Brennan has done in her short time here on funeral poverty. Like me, she came in at the tail end of a parliament, but she has immersed herself fully in the workings of this parliament and taking forward an amendment in the early days of being an MSP is quite daunting, and I congratulate her on all the work that she has done in the short time in this parliament and wish her well. The Scottish Government, as I said in my opening speech, has recently initiated work to examine fuel poverty, and that has been led by the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Communities and Pensioner Rights. And it builds very much on the cost of saying goodbye from Citizens Advice Scotland, and we should commend them on their report. And the Cabinet Secretary has commissioned further work on that, which will report early next year. And as has been said, there will be a conference in relation to this. In the response to the report, the Cabinet Secretary has indicated that we'll undertake a range of work to address funeral poverty, including speeding up the time taken to make decisions about the funeral payments that Jenny Mara mentioned, once responsibility for that is devolved to Scotland. Many members have raised the other parts of this bill that we've not perhaps spent much time on today. Kevin Stewart and others mentioned the reuse of layers and revitalising old burial grounds in our city and town centres. And I think that it will be important in going forward. So, Presiding Officer, this bill makes important changes to a subject that few of us wish to think about, but which touches us all, as Stuart Stevenson said at some point. I hope that Parliament will pass the bill unanimously when we come to decision time. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate on the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill, and it's now time to move to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion number 15993 in the name of Fergus Ewing on stage 3 of the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill. And I call on Fergus Ewing to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I commend the bill to Parliament and hope members will support it at decision time. I move the motion that the Parliament agrees that the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill be passed.
Many thanks. I now call on Nigel Dawn to speak on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Maximum 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak on the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill, though it does occur to me, as I said, that may be one of a rare breed that would be interested in speaking on this. This is a rare example of a consolidation bill, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee first had to decide whether consolidation was appropriate and then consider whether the text was clear, coherent and consistent, and whether the law really did remain unchanged as it must. The committee found that scrutiny of this consolidation bill was very much in keeping with the other work we carry out, as we are used to considering technical and complex legal matters. Like the Salmon and Freshwater Fisheries Consolidation Scotland Bill, which is the only previous example of a consolidation bill and was passed back in 2003, the Bankruptcy Bill was introduced late in the session. Now, the committee was able to undertake the necessary scrutiny of the bill in the short time available, but it should be noted that we were fortunate that we did not on this occasion need to consider a large number of Scottish Law Commission recommendations, as these would have made it much more challenging. There are other areas of law which would benefit from consolidation. Indeed, the committee recommended last year that the law on succession, some of which dates back to the 16th century, should be consolidated. This is another area of law which has widespread impact. Indeed.
Christine Graham.
Can I congratulate Nigel Dawn on the work of the DPLR committee, but would he agree with me that the recommendation of the Standards Committee that there should be two justice committees, a road we've already taken, is entirely flawed?
Nigel Dawn.
I hesitate, Presiding Officer, to say that anything's entirely flawed, but I will come on to the remit of my committee and what we might do in the future in just a moment, if the member will bear with me. I'm grateful to our clerks and legal advisers for their painstaking work. I also recognise and want to put on the record our appreciation of the essential role of Gregor Clark as draftsman for the Scottish Law Commission and the invaluable evidence of the Minister for Business, Energy and Tourism, the accountant in bankruptcy and Scottish Government officials. We also received evidence from practitioners. Their time and effort is very much appreciated. Not only did they challenge some of the proposals, but in the process they also gave us reassurance that the rest of the draft bill was fit for purpose. I'd like to reflect on the change remit of the committee. When I became convener of the Subordinate Legislation Committee in 2011, we looked only at subordinate legislation and the delegated powers in bills. Our remit has since been expanded to allow us to progress non-contentious bills drafted by the Scottish Law Commission and subsequently to consider consolidation bills like the one before us now. This has enabled the Parliament to do more. Three bills fully considered and progressed to royal assent, which would otherwise probably not have been dealt with. I know the Scottish Law Commission are grateful that this mechanism now exists, but I note in passing that there is a risk that they will now tailor their work to fit in with my committee's remit, rather than the wider reconsideration of the law, which would obviously be more appropriate. The revised remit of the committee has enabled us to address contract law and legal writings bill, the law of succession, and now the law on bankruptcy. And this list gives me a clue as to the range of other legislation which it might in future be appropriate for the committee to consider, for they're all part of what would be termed private law. Given, as the convener has already mentioned, the pressure on the Justice Committee will never go away, I suggest that this area of private law might be an area in which the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee might in future help them out a bit further. I would also like to reflect on the committee membership and our way of working. As a legislature, we enact just over one statute per month, but almost one statutory instrument per day. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considers each and every one of those instruments. Members will know that we are not concerned with the merits of the policy, but we do have to consider it to ensure the powers provided will actually do what the policy describes. We worry about the technicalities, all of them. We are the Parliament's engine room. Not everyone's cup of tea, of course, and I have no doubt that the whips have found that the mere threat of being sent to subledge has been enough to get some recalcitrant MSPs back into line in times past. But we need the right people to don the legislative boiler seat, and those members need to be prepared to work collegiately. Absolutely, from one of them.
Stuart Stevenson.
Absolutely empathise with what the convener of the committee is saying. But would you acknowledge we are also the guardians of the English language, and one of our greatest achievements in this session has been rescuing the word forthwith from legislative oblivion?
Nigel Dawn.
Makes a perfectly fair point, which will be explained by anybody who cares to look at the official report. We did have quite a lot of discussions about forthwith, decided that it wasn't a word you would probably meet in the pub, but one which we all understood and which should not be replaced. Just to return to the fact that we need the right people to don the boiler suit in this committee, it does occur to me that when you're trying to apply a chisel to the machinery of legislation, then it's important to know the member who's wielding the hammer is actually on the same side. And I do want to thank my colleagues that this is how we have worked. Returning to the bill itself, let me reiterate that we have gone to great lengths to ensure that we have not changed the law. I think this volume, therefore, has two uses, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I suggest to members that it will be very effective bedtime reading, though that's unlikely to be necessary after a hard day's canvassing. Secondly, for those who actually do need to access the substantive law on bankruptcy, it has been cunningly designed. For it starts at the beginning, it goes on to the end, and it stops.
Many thanks. I have an unexpected bid for an open debate speaker. Malcolm Chisholm, 2 minutes or so, please.
Thank you, President. I just wanted to say two things. Firstly, obviously, I welcome the bill and also the principle of doing consolidated bills, but the real reason I'm rising is because on this, my last day of legislation, I'm reflecting on my first day of legislation in 1992, which was the bankruptcy bill in the UK Parliament. And, of course, I think that was amending the 1985 bankruptcy bill, so no doubt it is featuring somewhere in today's bill, although I can't say that I've read every word of it. But it did make me reflect on two things. Firstly, I think we do stage one of bills much better than the UK Parliament, but let's just say the UK Parliament used to do stage two in a slightly different way, because in that, my first month in the UK Parliament, we sat literally till dawn listening to Donald Dewar and others giving speeches of an hour or more on one or two lines of that bill. I think perhaps that was a bit extreme in one direction, but perhaps sometimes at stage two we go to the other extreme. But I certainly welcome the bill and thank you for allowing me to speak.
Many thanks. And I now call on Fergus Ewing, Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank Nigel Dawn for his comments and thank you for allowing me to speak in support of the Bankruptcy Scotland Bill. It was almost 13 years ago to the day that this Parliament passed the last consolidation bill, which became, as Nigel Dawn said, the Salmon and Freshwater Fisheries Consolidation Scotland Act 2003. Consolidating legislation and tidying up the statute book is good practice, and I'm delighted that this bill has now progressed through stages one and two, and I hope we won't have to wait for 13 years for this opportunity to arise again, and if I may say so, if I have anything to do with it, that will not happen. I think it is one of the reasons why, as Malcolm Chisholm referred to Donald Dewar in his contribution, Donald Dewar remarked once that Scotland was the only country in the world which had its own legal system but lacked a legislature. And one of the functions of a legislature is to bring the law up to date. So, although this bill will never be the talk of the steamies, it nonetheless is extremely important for many reasons that I want briefly to canvass. Over the years, bankruptcy legislation has been so heavily amended that it's lost its coherence and structure. The numbering of the sections in the 85 Act had become complex, unwieldy, and inordinately long. I know that because I used to use it as an insolvency petition in the legal profession many, many years ago. So now is the right time to update the statute book in this area. The purpose is to bring Scottish bankruptcy legislation into one place and improve accessibility. And this will make it incredibly easier and simpler for practitioners who use the bill day and daily, but also for those who are affected by it to understand what the law is. Ignorance of the law is no excuse, and therefore it's our duty to make sure that it is possible to acquire knowledge by reading one document, not a plethora of documents. We work closely with stakeholders who have given valuable feedback in the proposals. This went back to August 2011, when the Scottish Law Commission published their Consolidation of the Bankruptcy Legislation in Scotland consultation paper, making a number of recommendations following responses to that consultation. Virtually all of these recommendations were implemented by the Bankruptcy and Debt Advice Scotland Act 2014, known on the streets as the Badass Act, as you know, Presiding Officer, which has allowed for a straight consolidation of the existing law in the bill. The evidence provided through the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee scrutiny has highlighted widespread support of the bill, and I would like to thank the committee, its lawyers and officials for their scrutiny and approach in communicating relevant issues with the drafter and the Scottish Government and all of the individuals who submitted their views. The exchanges between the committee and the Scottish Government have always been very positive and constructive, which improved the bill and enabled it to move smoothly and efficiently, and also avoid stage three amendments, which I'm sure is something that is appreciated by many members of this place. I'm also grateful for the work undertaken by the Scottish Law Commission, in particular Gregor Clark, who led on drafting the bill. The task involved in consolidating this legislation has been enormous, and I mean enormous, and I therefore do very much appreciate the huge amount of time and effort that's culminated in that good work. If it's passed today, I look forward to the bill receiving royal assent and its commencement, which we're planning for the 30th of November this year. Presiding Officer, If I may, as well as extending my gratitude to Nigel Dawn for his great work as convener of the busy committee, I'd also like to say a few remarks, given that it is possible that Nigel Dawn may not be returned to this Parliament in its next session. In case that is the scenario, I wanted to say a few words by way of tribute to Nigel Dawn. His very wide experience of life and work has informed, I believe, his substantial contribution to this Parliament over two terms and the past 9 years. Always rational, never personal, he has always played the ball, never the man.
Every contribution he has been made has been well informed and closely argued, sometimes probing, gently perhaps, but deftly and with great effect, the case the Scottish Government has put on any particular occasion. Presiding Officer, much about politics is partisan, perhaps too partisan, but that has never been the case in Nigel's manner. If I may say so, he is the least political politician that I've ever known in this place. I'm sure that all members present would join with me in wishing him well, and I do wish him well forthwith.
Many thanks, Minister, and I note your particular skill in sneaking in some unparliamentary language in an allowable way. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and I now suspend this meeting until 2 p.m.